Gordon was resting in a siding when Henry came by and said,
"Hello, fat face! Hello, fat face!"
Gordon was furious.
"What cheek! What cheek! That Henry is too big for his wheels. Fancy speaking to me like that. To me. To me, who has never had an accident. Never, ever had an accident."
Percy was a bit puzzled. "Oh, but Gordon, aren't jammed whistles and burnt safety valves accidents?"
"No, indeed, they are not accidents. Not accidents. They're, well, they're just high spirits. I mean, it might happen to any engine, but to come off the rails, well, I ask you, is it right? Is it decent, hmm?"
A few days later, it was Henry's turn to take the express. Gordon watched him getting ready.
"Better be careful, Henry. You're not pulling the flying kipper now, you know. Mind you keep to the rails today, won't you, hmm?"
And Henry went on his way. But Gordon didn't care. He yawned and went off to sleep. But he didn't sleep long because his driver came along and said,
"Come on, wake up, Gordon. A special train's coming and we're to pull it."
A special train? Is it coaches or trucks?"
"It's trucks."
"Oh, trucks. I don't like trucks."
They lit Gordon's fire and oiled him ready for the run. The fire was sulky and wouldn't burn, but they couldn't wait, so Edward pushed him onto the turntable to get him facing the right way. Gordon grumbled like anything.
"I won't go, I won't go, I won't go."
Edward said,
"Don't be silly, don't be silly, don't be silly."
Gordon tried hard, but he couldn't stop himself being moved. At last, he was on the turntable. Edward was uncoupled and backed away, and Gordon's driver and fireman jumped down to turn him round. The movement had shaken Gordon's fire. It was now burning nicely and making steam. But Gordon was cross and didn't care what he did. He waited till the table was halfway round and he said,
"I'll show 'em. I'll show 'em."
And he moved slowly forward. He only meant to go a little way, just far enough to jam the table and stop it turning as he'd done once before. But he couldn't stop himself, and he crashed through the side of the turntable and then through some wooden railings, and he slipped and slithered down a bank into a ditch. His wheels churned around in the mud.
"Oh, hey, my wheels are spinning. I can't get out. I can't get out. Please get me out. Please get me out."
But his driver and fireman said,
No, not a hope, not a hope. You're stuck, you silly great engine, you silly great engine. Don't you understand that? Don't you understand that, hmm?
They telephoned the fat controller, who said...
Yes, yes, yes. Oh, so Gordon didn't want to take the special and ran into a ditch. Hmm, oh, yes. What's that you say? The special's waiting? Well, tell Edward to take it, please. Yes. Gordon? Oh, leave him where he is. We haven't got time to bother about him now.
A family of frogs croaked at Gordon as he lay in the mud. On the other side of the ditch, some little boys shouted out,
Cool! Doesn't he look silly? They'll never get him out.
And they began to sing.
Silly old Gordon fell in a ditch, fell in a ditch, fell in a ditch. Silly old Gordon fell in a ditch all on a Monday morning.
Then the school bell rang and they chased off down the road. Gordon was in a mess and he said, And he blew away three tadpoles and an inquisitive newt. And Gordon lay in the ditch all day long. And he was very, very unhappy.
Oh, dear. I shall never get out. I shall never get out.
But that evening, they brought floodlights. Then, with powerful jacks, they lifted Gordon and made a road of sleepers under his wheels to keep him from the mud. Late that night, Gordon crawled home, a sadder and a wiser engine. Two men were cleaning Gordon. Gordon didn't like it.
My eye. You've got your holes in my eye. Oh, stop it.
Oh, shut up, silly. Shut up. Here, Bert, did you ever see such mud? No, Alf. I never did. You ought to be ashamed, Gordon, giving us extra work like this.
The hosing and the scrubbing stopped. The fat controller came along.
Now, wake up, Gordon, and listen to me, will you? Now, look, you will pull no more coaches until you're a really useful engine. Understand that? A really useful engine. So there.
So Gordon had to spend his time pulling trucks, and he felt his position deeply.
Goods trains. Oh, I ate goods trains. I ate them.
And he went up to the trucks and he banged them about. And they shouted out, James, who was watching all this, said, It's no good going on like that, Gordon. Trucks will be trucks, you know.
Ah, well, not with me, they won't. Not with me. I'll teach them. They tried to push me down the hill this morning, James. It's slippery there. You'll probably need some help with the express, you know.
Me? Help? I don't need any help on hills.
Gordon laughed. And got ready for his next train. And James went away to take the express. Slippery hills indeed. I don't need help. Come on, you coaches. Come on. The coaches grumbled, all in good time, bald in good time, bald in good time, bald in good time. The train was soon running nicely, but a distant signal checked them close to Gordon's Hill. Gordon's Hill used to be bleak and bare. Strong winds from the sea made it hard to climb. Trees were planted to give shelter, and in summer the trains run through a leafy avenue. Now autumn had come, and dead leaves fell. The wind usually puffed them away, but today rain made them heavy, and they didn't move. The home signal showed clear, and James began to go faster. He started to climb the hill.
Easy, do it, 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 easy, do it.
Halfway up, he was not so sure.
I must do it, I must do it, I must do it, I must do it, I must do it.
But try as he would, his wheels slipped on the leaves, and he couldn't pull the train at all.
What's the matter? What's the matter?
James's driver tried to calm him. Steady, old boy. Steady. The train slowly stopped. For although James's wheels were turning forwards, the whole train started slipping down the hill. James shouted,
"Help! Help! Help!"
James's driver shut off steam, carefully put on the brakes, and skillfully stopped the train. The guard came along and poked his head into the cab. Know what? Back to the station and send for a banker. So they brought the train safely down. But Gordon, who had followed with a goods train, saw what had happened.
Hello, James. I thought you could climb hills.
All James could say was, he hadn't enough steam.
Ah, well, James, we live and learn, don't we? We live and learn. Never mind, little James. I'm going to push behind. Now look, whistle when you are ready.
So James waited till he had plenty of steam, and then he went.
Right, Pullard, James, Pullard, we'll do it.
Clouds of smoke and steam towered from the snorting engines as they struggled up the hill.
We can do it.
We will do it.
We can do it.
We will do it.
We can do it.
We will do it.
The greasy rails sometimes made Gordon's wheels slip, but he never gave up, and presently they reached the top.
We've done it.
We've done it.
We've done it.
We've done it.
All right, James. Well, goodbye.
Goodbye, Gordon, and thank you very much indeed.
Gordon watched the coaches wistfully till they were out of sight. Then slowly he trundled back to his waiting trucks. One day, Thomas was at the junction when Gordon shuffled in with some trucks. Thomas said,
"Phew, what a funny smell. Can you smell a smell, Annie and Clarabel?"
No, I can't smell a smell, Thomas.
Oh, no, I can't smell a smell, Thomas. Yes, it's a funny sort of smell, isn't it, Gordon?
Well, no one noticed it till you did. It must be yours.
It isn't. Annie, Clarabelle, do you know what I think it is? It's ditch water.
Ditch water?
Yes, ditch water. Goodbye. I'm off.
Annie and Clarabelle could hardly believe their ears. They kept telling Thomas,
"You mustn't be rude. You make us ashamed."
"Well, you mustn't be rude. You make us ashamed."
But Thomas didn't care a bit. He just laughed.
"Oh, that was funny, that was. That really was funny."
He felt very pleased with himself. Annie and Clarabelle were deeply shocked. They had great respect for Gordon, the big engine. Thomas left the coaches at a station and went to a mine for some trucks. Long ago, miners digging for lead had made tunnels under the ground. Though strong enough to hold up trucks, their roofs could not bear the weight of engines. A large notice said, "Danger! Engines must not pass this board." Thomas had often been warned, but he didn't care. He'd often tried to pass the board, but he'd never succeeded, and he always used to say,
"Ha! Silly old board! Silly old board!"
This morning, he laughed as he puffed along, and he made a plan. He had to push empty trucks into one siding and pull out full ones from another. His driver stopped him, and the fireman went to turn the points. The fireman waved,
"Come on! Come on!"
And then Thomas started. The driver leaned out of the cab to see where they were going. And then Thomas saw his chance.
Right. Now.
And bumping the trucks fiercely, he jerked his driver off the footplate.
Hoorah! I've done it! I've done it!
And laughing like anything, Thomas followed the trucks into the siding, past the notice board. But suddenly, there was a rumbling and a groaning, and the rails quivered. The fireman jumped clear just as the ground sank and sank, and the rails sagged and broke, and Thomas dropped right down into the big hole that had suddenly appeared.
Oh, oh dear! Shh! Shh! Oh, fire and smoke! Oh, oh! Oh, oh, I'm sunk.
And he was. He could just see out of the hole, but he couldn't move.
Oh, oh dear. Oh, oh dear. Oh, I am a silly little engine. No.
Yes, and a very naughty one too, Thomas. I saw you.
It was the fat controller.
Oh, please, sir, get me out, sir, and I won't be naughty again.
Well,
I'm not so sure about that. We can't lift you out with the crane. The ground's not firm enough. Now, let me see. I wonder if Gordon could pull you out.
Oh, Gordon, yes.
Thomas didn't want to meet Gordon just yet. When Gordon heard what had happened, he started to laugh.
Down a mine, is he? Oh, what a joke. What a joke. Down a mine.
And he went off to rescue Thomas.
What a joke. What a joke. Hello, little Thomas. Hey, you are in a mess, aren't you, eh? Never mind. We'll have you out in a couple of puffs.
They didn't pull Thomas out in two puffs. Gordon was panting hard and nearly purple before he dragged Thomas out of the hole and safely past the board.
Oh, Gordon, I am sorry that I was so cheeky.
Oh, that's all right, Thomas. You made me laugh, you know, and, well, it did me good, you see, because I'm in disgrace, you know, and, well, I feel a bit low.
Oh, but I'm in disgrace too, Gordon.
Why, so you are, Thomas. We're both in disgrace. Look, shall we form an alliance?
An alley, what was it?
An alliance, Thomas. United we stand, together we fall. You help me, and I help you. How about that? Hmm?
Oh, right you are, Gordon.
Good. That settle then.
And buffer to buffer, the allies puffed home. The stations on the line were being painted. The engines were surprised. They asked the painters why the stations were being painted.
Well, because the Queen is coming. So there.
The engines in the shed were excited and wondered who would pull the royal train. Edward knew it wouldn't be him.
But I'm too old to pull important trains.
Gordon knew it wouldn't be him.
Well, I'm in disgrace. The fat controller would never choose me.
But James, the red engine, was confident.
Well, he'll choose me, of course. There's no doubt about it. No doubt about it at all.
But Henry couldn't agree.
Choose you?
choose you. You can't climb hills. He will ask me to pull it, and I'll have a new coat of paint. You wait and see.
The days passed, and Henry puffed about proudly, quite sure that he would be the royal engine. When it rained, Henry's driver and fireman stretched a tarpaulin from the cab to the tender to keep themselves dry. Henry puffed into the big station. A painter was climbing a ladder above the line. Henry's smoke puffed upwards in a big cloud. It was thick and black. The painter choked and couldn't see. He missed his footing on the ladder, dropped his paint pot and fell. Whoa! Plop onto Henry's tarpaulin. The paint poured all over Henry's boiler and trickled down each side, and the paint pot perched on Henry's dome. The painter clambered down and shook his brush at Henry. Ah, you spoil my clean paint with your dirty smoke, and then you take the whole lot and make me go and fetch some more, oh dear, oh dear, oh dear. The fat controller came pushing through the crowd.
Dear me. You look like an iced cake, Henry. That won't do for the royal train. Oh, no. I'm afraid that I must make other arrangements, yes.
And he walked over to the yard. Gordon and Thomas saw him coming, and both began to speak at once. Please, sir, I want...
Excuse me, sir, but I was thinking. Now, one at a time, please, one at a time. Now, what is it, Gordon?
Well, sir, I just wanted to ask you if Thomas could have his branch line back again.
I see. Uh-huh. And what do you want, Thomas?
Oh, pray, sir, can Gordon pull coaches again?
I see. So that's it. Well, you've both been quite good lately, and you deserve a treat, so when the Queen comes, Edward will go in front and clear the line, Thomas will look after the coaches, and Gordon will pull the train. Oh, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you.
The great day came. Percy, Toby, Henry and James worked very hard bringing people to the town. Thomas sorted all their coaches in the yard.
They're coming!
Edward steamed in, looking smart with flags and bright paint. 2 minutes passed, then five, then seven, and then ten, and then... Everyone knew that whistle, and a mighty cheer went up as the Queen's train glided into the station. Gordon was spotless, and his brass shone. Like Edward, he was decorated with flags, but on his buffer beam, he proudly carried the royal arms. The Queen was met by the Fat Controller, and before doing anything else, she thanked him for their splendid run. The Fat Controller bowed and said,
"Not at all, Your Majesty. Thank you."
And then the Queen said to the Fat Controller, "We have read a great deal about your engines. May we see them, please?" So he led the way to where all the engines were waiting. Toby and Percy said,
"They're coming! They're coming!"
Henry and James said, "Shh!" But Toby and Percy were too excited to care. The Fat Controller told the Queen their names, and she talked to each engine. Then, as she turned to go, Percy bubbled over.
"Oh, I say, 3 cheers for the Queen! Hip hip! Hip hip! Hip hip!"
The Fat Controller held his ears, but the Queen, smiling, waved to the engines till she passed the gate. Next day, the Queen spoke specially to Thomas, who fetched the coaches, and to Edward and Gordon, who took her away, and no engines ever felt prouder than Thomas and Edward and Gordon, the big engine.